My name is Randy Jaye. I'm your host for this History.com podcast, and it's entitled Remembering Lebanon, Pennsylvania's Legendary Colonial Theater. The Colonial Theater was built in 1923 at the northwest corner of 9th and Cumberland Streets. Now, more than 100 years later, its elegance has not been equaled locally. It was Lebanon's finest and most elaborately decorated and furnished theater. It also included the first commercial air conditioning system in the city. The Colonial Theater thrived when live theater shows such as vaudeville, barbershop quartets, and big band performances were all the rage. It also witnessed the transition from silent films to talkies. On October 1st, 1923, the Colonial Theater opened under extensive fanfare. Representatives of some of the most prominent motion picture agencies in the state of Pennsylvania were present. Luther G. Harpel, Lebanon's pioneering photographer, couldn't miss this opportunity as he took many pictures of the various groups of people that attended and other opening day activities. The Colonial Theater were designed and erected under the supervision of Richter and Eiler, registered architects of Reading, Pennsylvania. This firm was known for designing churches, hospitals, educational, and commercial buildings. Unfortunately, they got forced out of business in the 1930s during the Great Depression. The design of the Colonial Theater is identified as commercial Prairie-style architecture, and that's also known as Prairie School. America's greatest architect, Frank Lloyd Wright, was the pioneer of the Prairie School movement of architecture. Wright was inspired by the arts and crafts movement, and that was an international trend in the decorative and fine arts, which flourished in the United States from around 1880 up until the early 1920s. The Prairie School style incorporated the modern ideas that form follows function and is credited as the beginning of modern architecture. Many of the Prairie School style hallmark features were designed into the Colonial Theater, including a flat roof, grouped windows, horizontal lines, solid construction techniques, great brickwork, hand craftsmanship, simplicity, and function. Commercial features of the external part of the building included two storefront areas that included large commercial glass windows, and they were on the North 9th Street side, and a centrally located entrance vestibule with a standalone ticket booth. The basement originally included three large and two small stores. The exterior included bricks of various tones of beige and a large eye-catching corner sign. In the 1940s, that large corner sign was removed and replaced with a larger marquee canopy that was installed over the entrance of the theater. The interior was finished in what was called Adam style, also called Adamesque, and that was an 18th century neoclassical decorative style. The interior was really impressive and had a gorgeous work of art all over itself and included fancy wood moldings, sculptured walls, and hand-painted plaster panels and fantastic cornice work. The ceiling in the auditorium was adorned with ornamental hand-painted plaster. Beautiful draperies were arranged in long folds. Lighting fixtures included large semi-indirect lighting bowls hung from the main ceiling and several bracket wall lights hung throughout the building. These lighting fixtures provided a soft glowing color throughout the auditorium. In the early years of the Colonial Theater, silent films were shown accompanied by live music that was played on an organ located in the pit, which was in the front of the theater. In 1927, the jazz singer starring Al Jolson was the first full-length talking picture shown in the Colonial Theater. Al Jolson was one of the most famous and highest-paid stars of the 1920s. Modern film critics refer to him as the king of blackface performers. Al Jolson appears in a blackface character in The Jazz Singer. He did this since his early vaudeville career in order to gain popularity. Blackface entertainment is considered politically incorrect today, as it's obviously racist and offensive. Blackface entertainment started in minstrel shows about 200 years ago, and it was intended to be funny to white audiences. To the black community, blackface entertainment has always been demeaning and hurtful. White performers painted their faces black with burnt cork and wore tattered clothing to mock enslaved Africans, which included depicting them as lazy, ignorant, cowardly, and hypersexual. The Jazz Singer is one of the most important motion pictures in film history, as it marked the very end of the silent film era. During the 1920s and 30s, the Colonial Ballroom on the theater's second floor included a bandstand where big bands performed live for the enjoyment of many patrons who danced on the ballroom's wood floor. Many notable and interesting films were shown in the Colonial Theater over the years, including Gone with the Wind, Juarez, Airport, The Devil's Triangle, The Animal World, The Groove Tube, The Godfather, Twilight for the Gods, Love Story, and The World's Greatest Athlete. Some movies and live stage shows drew crowds that extended down Ninth Street, where hundreds of people waited in line to get into the Colonial Theater. In 1965, The Sound of Music was nominated for 10 Academy Awards, and they won five, including those for the Best Picture and Best Director. It is ranked number five of the best movies of all time and number four of the best musical movies of all time. Some music theater history here. When movies were popular before the days of the internet, advertisements in local newspapers allowed people to send away to get their movie theater tickets because they didn't want to stand in line in front of the movie theater for over half an hour up until 1 hour. Here's a sample of the beginning of one of the greatest films of all time. The Colonial Theater really experienced a gradual demise. In the early 1970s, shopping trends started moving away from the downtown areas into malls and suburbs. Moviegoers followed, and the business at the Colonial Theater, as well as the Academy and State Theaters, the two other downtown movie houses in Lebanon at the time, fell dramatically. The Colonial Theater started showing second runs of well-known films, as well as adult films, and hosting other events such as rock concerts in an attempt to stay in business. In 1977, the Colonial Theater was closed and put up for sale because the owners claimed its operation expenses were too high. In 1978, it reopened under new ownership and started showing films again, hosting live entertainment that was geared towards a family audience, and then they rented the facility out to clubs and organizations to bring in extra revenue. In 1982, the Colonial Theater was still managing to stay in business by rejuvenating live performances such as gong shows, barbershop quartet performances, and band concerts. However, these entertainment venues did not make enough money to keep the Colonial Theater operating, and it closed again. That was really the last time it was used as a traditional theater, and that was in 1982. Sometime during the early 1980s, the roof started to leak, and over the next several years, the condition of the roof worsened as needed repairs were not performed. This led to extensive water damage throughout the building and was a catalyst of major destruction to the roof and the ruination of the interior of the building. And by 1991, the building had deteriorated into a dreadful state of disrepair, and talk of it being demolished was circulating around the community. The Friends of the Colonial, a community action group dedicated to preserving the landmark, was formed, and they had plans to raise between $3 and $5 million to turn the Colonial Theater into a cultural arts center. 1994, bricks and debris started falling off the building, and it was really becoming a hazardous to the community. In January 1996, the building was sold for only $49 to Thomas Conti of Easton at a judicial tax sale. After Conti attempted to make no repairs to the building, the city of Lebanon fined him and put liens on the building because of violation of building codes. The roof alone was estimated to be $500,000. During 1997 and 1998, attempts to sell the building to various developers and investors failed. The site of the Colonial Theater was promoted as having lucrative commercial potential, but the lack of nearby bustling business activity and really a lack of foot traffic in the area prevented the sale of the building. In 1999, the city of Lebanon took possession of the building, by agreeing to waive all the fines and liens that they had placed against the building's owner. On August 31st, 1999, the Pennsylvania Historic Preservation Officer agreed with the City of Lebanon to request funds to demolish the Colonial Theater. By 2000, the building was far beyond economical repair. It was actually a public hazard, and it was deemed an eyesore. The City of Lebanon really had no choice but to order the demolition of the structure. Prior to demolishing it and during the possibility of sales, the City of Lebanon, this is back in 1993, the City of Lebanon agreed to pay $16,900 for a feasibility study to do a market analysis to determine if the Colonial Theater really could be repurposed into a community arts center. A consulting firm named Daniel L. Prati and Company of Madison, Wisconsin, was hired to perform the work. On October 1993, the firm said that the plan to renovate the Colonial Theater would work because they really didn't want the irreplaceable architectural in the area to be demolished and to really create gaps in the cityscape of Lebanon. However, the renovation project now was estimated to cost $6 million and take several years to complete. Additionally, they suggested that the city offices be moved into the Cumberland Street area to show support for downtown revitalization. Well, all of these things did not happen, and this picture here demonstrates what an artist rendition of a new renovated Colonial Theater Arts Center would have looked like, but of course it never happened. The demolition of the Colonial Theater happened in 2000. This is when the Colonial Theater building lost its battle against the ravages of time and the elements, and a company named Empire Services out of Reading was paid $207,000 from the city's Federal Community Development Block Grant funds to come in and demolish the building and haul away all the debris. By August 2000, the building was completely gone, and that created a large void in downtown Lebanon's cityscape. Today, there is no marker or any other evidence on the northwest corner of 9th and Cumberland Street to indicate that a once elegant theater called the Colonial had stood there. A parking lot now takes up the space where the Majestic Theater stood for over 77 years. The Colonial Theater is by no means forgotten and will remain part of Lebanon's folklore for many years to come. However, it's in the undesirable list of lost historic Lebanon landmarks that includes such structures as the Eagle Weimer Hotel, the George Dawson Coleman Mansion, the Gingrich Memorial Swimming Pool, the Key Drive-In, the Lebanon County Courthouse, St. Mary's Catholic Church, and the Weaver Mansion.